Father, we are so much glad even to be called your children. We are so much glad even to be in your presence, knowing that, Father, your wisdom is infinite. Knowing, Father, there's nowhere we can find wisdom like your wisdom. There's nowhere we can find strength. There's nowhere we can find hope. It's only in you. For you are our beginning and the end. You are the one who created us. And Father, you created us for your purpose. And Father, you've given us your word to be a guide. You've given us your word to be our strength. You've given us your word to keep us in the path that you've ordained. May you come and speak to us. May you come and encourage. May you come and strengthen. May you come and teach us. And may you come and bless every one of us. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray and believe.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
All the time.
Hallelujah. God wants us to understand that though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, He is with us. Hallelujah. In this world, there's going to be dark moments. Some of those dark moments, we walk by ourselves into them. And some of those moments, we just find ourselves in those moments of darkness. It doesn't matter whether you walk into those moments of darkness or you found yourself in those moments of darkness. God wants to know you that even though you walk through that valley of the shadow of death, don't fear no evil. He's there to guide us. He's there to bring us out. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us in the book of Psalms 23, I believe all of us know it by heart, the psalm which David wrote. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. He says, the Lord. When David says the Lord, he already establishes the relationship that is between him and God. Because when he calls God to be the Lord, it means that he is the servant. He says, God, you're the master. God, you're the one who says, you're the one who directs. And again, he says, the Lord is my shepherd. Meaning that if the Lord is the shepherd, I am the sheep. And if I'm the sheep, then I have to look at the shepherd. Hallelujah. It is the shepherd that is guiding me. It is the shepherd that is leading me. Hallelujah. And he says, he makes me. Now he's talking about who? The shepherd. It's the shepherd that is making me to lie down in green pastures. Meaning that the shepherd desires the best for his children. God desires the best for you. Hallelujah. He leads me beside still waters. He's always bringing you in a good place. If at all we are going to follow the leadings and the guidings of the shepherd, he leads us beside still waters. If we refuse to be wise in our own ways, but in all things we acknowledge him, the Bible tells us he is going to direct your path. He says the steps of the righteous, they are ordered by the Lord. And he says as many as are led by the Spirit of the Lord, they are the sons and daughters of God. That's how God is guiding you. If you are led by the Lord, if you allow the Spirit of the Lord to lead you, you will not be in the wrong place. You'll always be in the right place at the right time. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness, because you know righteousness makes way. Righteousness opens the way for blessing. Wherever there is righteousness, there is exaltation. Wherever there is sin, there is death. So he leads you in a way that he may bless you. That's why he leads you in the way of righteousness and say, yeah, though I walk. Now he didn't say the Lord is leading him through the valley. He said, Though myself now I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Now it is him walking. It's not the Lord leading him. He's walking by himself. Sometimes we walk into darkness. Sometimes we walk in disobedience. Sometimes we walk in what God has not us to walk in. He says, there is going to be time when you walk in this places. I want us to look at that time in the life of David when he walked through the valley of the shadow of death. When he found himself in a place of darkness. When he found himself in a place of discouragement. Where he found himself in a place he didn't have the confidence even to ask anything from the Lord. I want us to open our Bibles in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 30. This is the time when David had been anointed to be the king. But we know when God anointed David to be the king, he didn't become the king the following day, nor the following year. He took time for David to become the king. And in between him being the king and being anointed, he had to come to a place where he feared for his life. He had to hide. He had to run away from his land. And the prophet came and told him, "You should know that you've been anointed. Don't you go and dwell among the enemies." God told David, "I want you to remain within the boundaries. Remain within Judah." Hallelujah. Don't be tempted to go hide somewhere beyond the boundaries. But David, because of the constant battle, because of the constant threat of his life, in chapter 27, after two times King Saul came against him and tried to kill him, he said, "It looks as if I'm going to die very quickly, and therefore let me run and go and hide among the enemies of God, the enemies of Israel." So he went to dwell in the city of Philistines. And when he was dwelling in the city of Philistines, David now dwelt and had another kind of lifestyle. Because the Bible tells us he was given accommodation by this king. And he wanted to show this king that he hates Israel and is against Israel. So he'll go and commit riots. He'll go and kill the cities. And the cities he go and destroy people. He kill everyone, that there'll be no one to come and say anything. Then he come back to the king and said, "Hey, today I attacked the south of Judah. Today I attacked this." He was lying. He was doing things not the right way. He came to a place where he found himself doing things not what he wanted to do. And now it came to a time now there will be a war between the enemies of Israel and the Israel itself. And in this battle, because David had proved himself that he can kill the Jews according to what he was saying to the king, he was told, "This battle you are going to go and fight. You are going to fight the Israel. You are going to fight in this battle against your own people." And he was ready, and he called his army, and they were marching forward. And God intervened, and he made those people to say, "No, this man, we can't trust him. Let him go back." But because of the decision he had made, he left his camp in Ziklag and went to fight. This is what happened. That's why we are in 1 Samuel chapter 30. Amen. Are we all there this moment? Okay, let's read together from verse number 1. Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag, that is after being told they can't fight in this battle, on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south of Ziklag, attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire. They had burned and attacked where the wives and the children of David and his armies were, and they had destroyed everything with fire and taken away captive the wives and the children. And then had taken the women and those who were there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but they carried them away and went their way. So David and his men came to the city where it was burned and with the fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters had been taken captive. And then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. They cried. They had lost everything. They had lost their wives. They had lost their children. They had lost any hope. And therefore they cry to the point they could no more cry. You can imagine men crying to the point they can't cry no more. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelite and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken. Now David was greatly distressed. This was the lowest, the darkest moment of David. For the people spoke, the people, we are talking about the army, those who are banded together with David, those who are walking out with David, those who become his close friends. Now they are the people, they were talking about stoning him. He didn't know where to go. His very friends, the ones he's been leading them for some time, they want to stone him. The wife is gone. The children are gone. Everything is gone. And now he's all alone in that dark place. Nobody has come to tell him, oh, you know, it is going to be. There is no one comforting him. Instead, they're saying, this man deserves to die. He's a bad leader. He's the cause of all these things. It was very dark in that moment. You can imagine David alone. Nobody there to strengthen because everybody's crying. And instead, they're talking, this man, we are going to stone him. Because of the soul of their people was grieved, and every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. That's why he could only be able to find strength. In that dark moment, in that dark valley, in that place through the valley of the shadow of death, death was around him, because if they could have stoned him, he will die. But in that moment, David found strength in the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. When you go through those moments of darkness, there are moments there will be no one even there to comfort you. There will be no one even to understand what you go through, what you think, what has been happening, the turmoil that is in your life. But in those moments is the moment only God can be able to strengthen you. Only God understands. Only God knows what is your desire. Only God knows what you've been going through. Only God can be able to comprehend. There are sometimes even things you may share, or maybe you'll have shared with anyone. People run away instead of coming near to him. But when he shared with God, God understood. God understood. God strengthened him. Hallelujah. The Lord is our strength. The Lord is our strong tower. That's why we need God more than anyone else. Hallelujah. More than anything else. Having friends is good. But those friends may not be there the moment you need them. No matter how much they want, they can't be there when you need them. They can't help you the way you need it. But God can do that. Hallelujah. They can't understand when you cry sometimes. They can't understand when you're down. They can't. But God can be able to understand. That's why somebody sang and said, what a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Hallelujah. He is a friend that sticks closer to you. He is a friend that knows your heart. He is a friend that understands your pain. He is a friend that knows what it means to be rejected and to be down. So David started strengthening himself in the Lord. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David. And David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue? You can imagine this kind of a prayer. He's asking God. This is a judgment. He felt as if it is a judgment upon his life. And he's inquiring, God, shall I pursue? Or shall I let go my wives and my children? Shall I follow? He was not praying with certainty. God, I want to follow after these people. I want you to be with me. But he said, God, shall I pursue these people? Will I be able to overcome them? Will I be able to defeat them? Shall I go? How David praying such kind of a prayer. It shows us the kind of a state and the kind of a place he was. Where he was uncertain whether, is it the will of God for me to pursue or to follow these people? Shall I pursue? Yet it is my wife. Yet it is my children. Yet it is everything that belongs to me. Everything that is special that is gone. But shall I pursue these things? He was really in a dark place. He was in a place where maybe himself, he was feeling condemned. He was feeling, I deserve whatever has befallen me. I deserve to suffer. I deserve all these things. But we serve a gracious and good God. Hallelujah. And God told him, he said, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered and said, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all. Hallelujah. That's all that David wanted to hear. That was a message of grace. That was a message of acceptance. That was a message that David loved to hear, because he knew it was grace. Hallelujah. He knew he was about to go to a battle that God had not sanctioned that battle. He knew he was about to go and fight the chosen generation. And now God has said, I've given you grace. Go after these people and you're going to overcome them. Hallelujah. And that's how always God sometimes comes in our life. At those moments when you don't feel a sin, you really deserve anything from the Lord. You feel as if you've exhausted all the mercies. You feel as if you've exhausted all the grace. You feel, is there anything waiting for me? God, do I deserve anything? And God says, my mercies, they are new every morning. And great is my faithfulness. When I said, you are my son, when I said, you are my daughter, when we made a covenant with you, I don't make covenant and break. My covenant remains forever. Hallelujah. My covenant remains forever. The covenant that God has given unto us is a covenant that remains forever. Glory to God. When you look also at the life of Jacob, we know the life of Jacob. Jacob was a twin brother to Esau. And him being the twin brother to Esau, Esau was the firstborn. He deserves all the birthright. And the day came when the father Isaac wanted to give blessings upon them. And therefore, he called Esau, his first son, and said, come, make something for me, and I'm going to bless you. That is in Genesis 27. But the mother Sarah loved Jacob more than Esau. He said, do this. I'm going to prepare something. Go and take the blessing. So he made the deception and everything. And Jacob himself came bearing the food and said, I am Esau. I want you to bless me. And he was blessed. After he was blessed, Esau comes and prepares food and brings before the father and say, I'm back. And the father said, your brother has already come and taken the blessing. So he deceived, or he took by deception, the blessing which the father wanted to give. The father in the natural wanted to give to Esau. And the Esau said, you are going to die. So the father, or the parents of Jacob, said he needs to run away to go and live by Laban. And as he was running away, Jacob in himself, he was feeling that really he had done something which was not right. And the Bible tells us, as he was going, chapter 28, he had a sleep, and he slept on this rock, and he saw the heaven open and the angels coming up and down. When he woke up and said, he was surprised that God is in this place, and I did not know. Why he did not know? Because he didn't feel as if he needed to be, or the Lord needed to be with him. Because he was running, because he had taken the blessing from his brother and he had deceived his father. And this God told him, I'm going to be with you. And therefore, he made a covenant at the end of that chapter and said, God, if surely you are going to be with me, if surely you are going to be with me, I'm going to give you the tenth of everything I get, and I'll always worship you. Hallelujah. So the time came for Jacob to go back to his land, and now he wants to go back and meet the one who said, I'm going to kill you. It was the most darkest moment in his life. He feared, he knew he's going to die. He thought he's going to die, and in that moment, he was just alone in that valley, and he wrestled with God. I want us to look at Genesis 32. Genesis 32. He was fearful. It was the night before the meeting of his brother. He don't know whether the heart has changed. He don't know, he's fearful. He's fearing his children might be killed. His wives might be killed. He's in that place. Verse 22. And he rose that night and took his two wives and his two female servants and his 11 sons and crossed over the ford of Jacob. And he took them and sent them over the brook and set over what he had. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint, and he wrestled with him, and he said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And he said to him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and men and have prevailed. Hallelujah. Amen. Then Jacob said, tell me your name, I pray. And he said, why is it that you ask about my name? And he blessed him there and there. Hallelujah. Amen. This is the dark moment of Jacob. He's about to meet his brother, and now he's wrestling in prayer. He's praying, and a man appears with him, and he's wrestling with him. And even the day is about to go, and the man says, "Let me go." And he says, "I'm not going to let you go until you bless me." And he asks him, as if he don't know who he is. He says, "What is your name?" And he says, "My name is Jacob." It was a night of confession. That darkest moment. Hallelujah. Yeah. He was coming to admit that he was a liar. The word Jacob means he's a supplanter, a deceiver. And he says, "I confess I'm Jacob." And he says, "Now from today onwards, I'm changing your name. You are going to be called a prince." So those moments of darkness, those moments of value of darkness, when we come and we find ourselves in those moments, that's the moment that God wants us to come to a place where we confess who we are and where we are and our weakness. Hallelujah. That's the moment we come and say, "God, I need you to break me," because God doesn't want you to leave that place the same way. He wants you to leave that place better. He wants you to be transformed. So that's a moment he's breaking you. He's molding you. He wants you to confess. Hallelujah. Because when you confess with your mouth, "I'm weak here." The Bible says that from that morning, when the morning was walking, he was walking different. Hallelujah. Because when you go through a valley of darkness, when you're in the moment of darkness, when you come out, your walk should be different. Something has to change, because in that moment when you're crying, when you're seeking for God's mercy, when you gave your vow to God and say, "God, if only you deliver me this time, I'll serve you, I'll give you sacrifice," in the morning you just want to serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Because you knew in that moment, it's only by the mercy, it's only by the grace of God. Hallelujah. So Jacob confessed and said, "I'm Jacob." And he said, "From today onwards, I've changed your name. I've changed everything about you. Now you're going to be called Israel." Hallelujah. So dark moments, walking through the valley of the shadow of death, they are very important. It's part of our walk with the Lord. Hallelujah. There'll be times when God will take us through the wilderness. Those were dark moments for the children of Israel. The Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy 8, "Why did I take you through that dark moment? That you may learn, that you may know that man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeded from the mouth of God." Hallelujah. So it's a place, that valley, we can turn it, or God wants to turn it to a place of, it's a school where you are learning that you shall not live on bread alone, you shall not live on friends alone, you shall not live on what you've been trusting alone. You can only live by the Lord and the Lord alone. Hallelujah. When you call, everyone is not there. When you try to go everywhere, everywhere is closed. Then you have to go by yourself and say, "Only you and you, God alone." Hallelujah. Amen. It's a place where we learn. Amen. That's why we need it. Amen. It's a place in the midst of your pain, in the midst of your disappointment, in the midst of your failures. This is a place where we bring God and we come to God. Hallelujah. Many people have opened their pains or their wounds to people, and the people, they have put salt on top of them. It's become more painful instead of healing. But in those dark moments, when those pain, you just lay your wound open to the Lord, and the Lord will touch your wound. So that God will heal you, God will strengthen you. Hallelujah. You've been disappointed, you may share people about your disappointment. Instead of encouraging you, they'll go and celebrate it. But when you tell God about your disappointment, God understands, and God will bring you up. Hallelujah. We need those moments. Hallelujah. Job didn't know well about his friends. He had three friends. He called them friends. But when he went through trouble, that's who he knew who they were. They say, "You are a sinner. You are bad." He didn't know they used to think about him that. Hallelujah. Unless you go through trouble, you'll never know what people think. But when you go through, God will make you know what they think. Hallelujah. What was on their mind all time. And so those moments are there that God may reveal who is a true friend, who is the one to walk with, who is the one to trust, who is the one to go with. Hallelujah. Even in those dark moments, as we said in the case of David, is the moment where you don't trust in yourself no more. Most of us, and most of the time, and most of the saints, they are over confident. And when they are looking things from that position of being overconfident, they look down on other people. And they don't understand others. But once you yourself been there and you have received grace, you can also be able to give grace. Hallelujah. You can know that also you in yourself, nobody wants to be weak. No one body wants to be in that place. But when you've been there, then you realize it's not by power, it's not by might, but it's only by the Spirit of the Lord. You know that it's not for him that willeth, nor for him that runneth, but for God who shows his mercy and compassion. Hallelujah. That's when you know that you're standing not because of your own strength, you're standing by the grace of God. That's when you don't trust on your own wisdom, you don't trust on your own knowledge, but you trust in the grace of God. Hallelujah. We need to know that. We need to come to a place where you still know you depend on God. It's God that is holding you. It's God that is keeping you. It's God that is guiding you. It's God that gives you the power to say no. Hallelujah. It's God who is always with you. Let us not ever be self-confident. Let always depend on God. He is our strength. We can lean on him. We can call on him. Hallelujah. In him we stand. In him we move. In him we have our strength. Hallelujah. We are strong because he is in us. Amen. Glory to God. And it's in those moments of weakness. All of us sometime in one way or another, we are going to go through moments of weaknesses or any moment in your life. Hallelujah. Your weakness may not be her weakness. His weakness may not be your weakness. Everybody has his own. But God is dealing with us in every aspect. Hallelujah. And in those moments is the moment that God is looking unto us. God wants us to come before him that he may be able to give us strength. Hallelujah. Whatever the pride is about to come up, you may find yourself in that place that God may make sure that pride is broken. Hallelujah. That you may not be proud, you may not lose the blessing that God has ordained in our life. Amen. One thing for certain is that God, our Father, he sees us as his children. He knows our struggling. He knows how sometimes the things we go through. He knows sometimes, even when you fall and you pretend you've not fallen, he knows everything about us. And his love is there to give us strength when we can call upon him. He says, when you call upon the Lord in the day of trouble, he is going to deliver you. He is going to strengthen you. He is going to make you to be strong. Hallelujah. I want us to look at Romans 8. From verse number 1, he says, therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk. The word walk is live. Who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Hallelujah. Anyone that is in Christ Jesus who does not live, that is not your lifestyle. Flesh is not your lifestyle. You don't walk in it. Your lifestyle is walking in the Spirit. Walking in the Spirit is walking in the Word of God. Walking in the Spirit is everything that is in you desires to please God. In every moment, you want to be righteous. In every moment, you want to have a right standing with God. He says, now there is no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but their purpose and their heart is to live according to Jesus. Amen. For the law of spirit of life, in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did it by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On the account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be filled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Hallelujah. Every time you are walking with God, every time we are in this covenant, we are walking, we have a desire, we are walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. And therefore, even when you go through those valley of the shadow of death, He says, I'm with you. When you go through the fire, when you go through the waters, I'll be with you. Hallelujah. When you go through those moments, just like Jacob, you didn't know and you didn't expect that God is, He says, I'm still with you. Hallelujah. When you may be weeping for night, because it's a weeping may endure for that night. Even in that night, when you are crying, when you are weeping, the Lord says, I am with you, because you are not walking in the flesh. You are not living in the flesh. You are not living in the things of the world. You are living in the Spirit. And He says, in the morning, joy is going to come. Just like for the life of David, we know the Lord removed him from that shadow of the valley of death. He was there to protect him. He was there to give him strength. And therefore God is saying, He is there to give us the strength. We can call on Him. We don't call on God only when you're strong. Call on God even when you're weak. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. You don't call the Lord only when you feel like. You call the Lord even when in your head everything you are feeling as if, whatever you're feeling, God is there. We call on Him because we need Him. He is our strong tower. He is our strength. Because when you don't call on Him, when you don't have strength, where is your strength going to come from? But when you come before Him, even if it's crying, even if it's only, you know, you're saying only one word, He's a Father who is always there, ready to receive us, ready to welcome us back. But He wants us to see us coming back. Hallelujah. When you're calling Him, you are coming back. When you're calling Him, you're saying, God, I need you. And He's going to come and receive us and embrace us. Hallelujah. The prodigal son, when he came to himself in that dark valley of the shadow of death, where he was feeding with the swines, he came to himself and he decided to go back to the Father, and the Father received him. Hallelujah. It is for us to come back in the presence of the Lord. It's for us to find strength in the presence of the Lord and know that God is going to heal us. Hallelujah. God is going to make us stronger. God is going to perfect us. Through going through the dark, the valley of the shadow of death makes us to hate sin. Makes us to love God more. Makes us to desire to walk right with God. Hallelujah. Makes us to know that how God is so much necessary in our lives. Amen. He makes us know that we need God in every situation. So let's embrace Him. Let's walk in Him. Let's walk in His word. Let's call upon His name. And He says, though there are times you're going to walk through that valley, I'll be with you. The scripture I was reading, and it is not escaping my mind, is in the book of Luke chapter 24. This scripture is not leaving me, and I want to share it as we are coming to a close. This is when Jesus rose from the grave. Jesus had been talking about His resurrection, but none of them understood. So the women had already prepared spices to go and anoint the body of Jesus. So on the first day of the week, they came in the temple, to the tomb. And as they came there, they found that the stone had been rolled away and an angel was standing there. This is the question the angel asked them. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, Why do you seek the living among the dead? Why do you seek life in what is dead? Why do you seek the living among the dead? In this world, where the devil is the one that is in charge, there is no help you can find from the world. Everything is dead in this world, but we can find our help from the Lord. Hallelujah. We can find life in the word of God. We can find life in the presence of the Lord. So in those moments here, we don't go after the dead things. Go among the living thing. Go before God. Go where there is life, that you may get life. Don't go where you're going to be discouraged and be discouraged. Go where there is life. Hallelujah. Go where you're going to be built up. When you're in those moments, it's not the day you go to those houses they call the house of courage, and they sit on those high stools there. After that, your misery and your trouble follow. You know, that is the day you come to the presence of the Lord and worship the Lord. Amen. We seek life where life is. We don't seek life among the dead. Amen. And God will strengthen every one of us, and God will give you victory. Amen. We are the sons and daughters of the Most High God, and God has made a covenant with us. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. Let us entrust Him in those moments. Let us entrust Him with our weakness. Let us entrust Him with your disappointment, with your pain, whatever it is. Entrust the Lord with it, and God will lift you up. Hallelujah. Amen. God will encourage you, and God will do a new thing. Let's stand on our feet this afternoon. Father, I want to thank you, even to know that when we go and when we walk by ourselves in those moments of darkness, when you make the wrong choices, because you tell us in your word in the book of Deuteronomy, you've given us the power, you've given us the right to choose life or death, blessing or curse. And Father God, whatever choice we made, O Jehovah God, you say, though we may walk even in that valley, when we call upon your name, Father, you're going to come through. You're going to deliver us. You're going to quicken us. You're going to perfect everyone. Father, I pray this afternoon, be there anyone that has been through this valley? Be there anyone that is about to go in this valley? Be there anyone is already on the dark mountain where everything is looking dark? There is no prospect of anything. Is there anyone that is the place where David was, that if there is nowhere he can turn to the left or to the right? I pray, Father, the strength that you gave David is going to come alive in their life this moment. Oh, they are going to see light where there is darkness. Oh, you are going to be a light to them in the midst of whatever is surrounding them. Those who are surrounded by the cloud of hopelessness, oh, those who are surrounded by the cloud of difficult things before them, decisions to be made. Father God, we know by your wisdom, by your direction, they can be able to make the right decision. Or they can be able to come out. You say in everything that comes our way, there is always a way of escape. The rod and the staff, let them comfort those who need to be comforted tonight. Father, strengthen those who need to be strengthened tonight. Encourage those who need to be encouraged tonight. Oh, visit those who need to be visited, Father God. Oh, may you manifest your presence upon your children tonight, like you did in the life of Jacob. At that moment when he was not expecting, oh Lord God Almighty, you came and you showed yourself. You came and revealed yourself, and you woke up in wonder. I pray, Jacob, God, there is going to be a wonderment in the life of everyone tonight, because it's not about our power or our strength. It's only by your grace. It's only by your enablement. It's only by your visitation. May you visit tonight. May you confirm your inheritance tonight. May you confirm your children tonight. As you make extraordinary doors, as my Father, you do extraordinary blessing, extraordinary visitation upon everyone tonight, that you may lift up every soul tonight, and that Father, you may strengthen every one of us, and we may know, Jehovah God, as we made a decision, we are not going to trust on ourselves, but we are going to lean on thee, Jesus. We are not going to be wise in our own ways, but in all things, Father God, we are here because we acknowledge you, God. We acknowledge you know everything, and that you are going to direct our path. Father, open those doors that need to be opened. Father, grant grace in every aspect of our life. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen. We pray and believe. Amen. Hallelujah. Maybe you're here this afternoon. You've never given your life to Jesus. I want you to give you this moment to respond to this word that God has given unto us. Or maybe you're in the one, you're also in that valley, or you feel the valley is there of the shadow of death, where you don't know, you don't understand, you don't feel anything. Thing. This is your moment. Come forward, and we are going to pray together. Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus.
I surrender. Oh, to thee my. Oh.